The more dollars that there exist,
the less value they have.
The lower the value that they have.
Yep.
Is there something we can do possibly to protect ourselves against the steadily eroding value in international markets of the U.S. dollar? And the article by Robert Fisk is one of the results. Now, there have been several moves on this over the years, but it's interesting, though, on within a month or two of Saddam Hussein's announcement that henceforth Iraq's oil was going to be denominated in something other than U.S. dollars.
The euro, I think he was talking about.
He was talking about the euro, and suddenly he has, you know, the skies of Iraq are filled with American and British jets and so on. When the Iranians became very serious.
That's right, it was about a couple of months after he announced he would be selling oil in euro, not U.S. dollars, weapons of mass destruction raison d'etre for invading Iraq occurred.
Indeed, and about 3, 4, 5 years ago, Iran began to make similar sorts of noises, and the drumbeats of war from Washington began to reverberate. Why would this be? In an extreme case, if oil is denominated in a currency other than the U.S. dollar, say in euros or a basket of currencies that you described, in an extreme case, the demand in international markets for U.S. dollars falls off. The value of it slides at an ever-accelerating pace. And how does America finance itself? Well, it has to issue more and more dollars. How does it persuade people to hold them? By increasing rates of interest and so on. So in an extreme case, that would be a possible result. That's to say the slide of the U.S. dollar accelerates. But there's – go ahead.
Well, Chris, I was going to say – I want to wind back a bit. So they've since the beginning of this year, actually, there has been talk amongst many nations of changing, having a new global reserve currency. They've been quite open about it.
Yes.
But this one is unusual, a little bit unusual, and you've had a look at Robert Fisk's argument. This one's unusual because it's specifically Arab oil states together with China – Russia.
And indeed, on the sidelines are India, Brazil, and major, if you like, up-and-coming...
new nations, if you like, emerging nations, I guess.
Precisely right.
Emerging industrialized nations.
Correct, yes.
All right, now, that would appear to change the balance of power, at least economically.
Potentially, that's exactly right. Now, is it the case that...
just come closer to the microphone, if you would, please,
Chris. Is it the case that economic developments over the past, or financial developments since 2007, has that hastened America's relative decline, or has it revealed what was a decline that existed all along, that the net debt of the U.S. is on the order of $15 trillion? Add to that the very stimulus packages. That virtually doubles it. People are looking at this and saying, goodness me, America's financial condition is worsening and worsening at an accelerating pace. We other countries need to do something about this in order to adjust to its weakening state.
So how much debt does the United States have at the moment?
What's called on-balance sheet debt, if you look at its assets and liabilities and so on, as we speak, the national debt, in other words, that's built up since 1789, on the order of roughly $13 trillion. Add to that the various stimulus packages in various forms, bank guarantees, bailouts, GM bailouts, et cetera, et cetera. Add another crudely $12 trillion to that. The real difficulty, though, is what's called their off-balance sheet liabilities. That's to say Medicare, Medicaid, Social Security, pharmaceuticals expenditures that they'll have to pay in future decades to people as they age. Estimates there vary, but the bidding begins at about $70 trillion. In other words, America... basically, the Federal Reserve has analyzed this, and they come with understated conclusions, but they do not disagree with the conclusion that America has dug itself into a debt pit from which it cannot extricate itself.
So Marx was right. Capitalism will destroy itself.
No, Marx was dead set wrong, of course. The communism fails. What we've talked about, this fiat currency, is imposed by governments. It's not a creature of the free market. A gold standard was when individuals are left to decide what is something that has value amongst us. Going back to the time of the Egyptians, free people, of which they haven't existed that often in human history, I'll allow, free people come up with gold. Governments hate gold because governments cannot readily increase the money supply, and it's quite significant. The heyday of the gold standard, when Napoleon was defeated at Waterloo, what was that, roughly 1815, till the time of the outbreak of the First World War, basically a century of peace considered between world powers, European powers and America. The U.S. Civil War was the major exception. Why was that? Because under a gold standard, governments cannot ransack the population. They cannot wage war under a fiat currency, which is why the gold standard was abandoned during the First World War. That's the only way by which governments can finance warlike expenditure. So it seems to me it demonstrates the futility of socialism to say, look, a fiat currency by definition is going to fail, and we're seeing that in slow motion here. Now, this could take years, it could indeed take decades, but it simply doesn't work because underlying it is nothing. It has no inherent value.
Robert Fisk, in his article, argues essentially that nothing can really be locked in for at least sort of nearly a decade in terms of trading in something other than the US dollars.
Well, that's right. And indeed, the model which his article mentions, this basket of currencies, in effect, that's quite unstable too, because this basket will consist in what are the currencies, what percentage will the Chinese currency be, what percentage will the Russian be, and there's going to be incessant jockeying about that. So my guess would be that basket of currencies isn't going to work either. I note with great interest over the past several years, the Russians have spoken in quite positive terms about a gold standard. And lo and behold, because they're a major producer of gold, that's they're talking their book, as it were. The Chinese have
to their advantage. Yep. Mm-hmm.
To their advantage, the Chinese too have said, "Gee, perhaps something." Along the lines of a gold standard is interesting. A fellow, Robert Mundell, who won a Nobel Prize roughly 10 years ago, he shocked people. People were literally jaw-dropping stuff because in his Nobel speech, he said, gee, a gold standard has some very positive attributes, and we're worse off without something that at least has gold as a component. So looking in the background, governments hate it because gold limits government's power. Governments can't do the sorts of things that they become accustomed to doing over the past, 50, 60 years since the...
Printing
money at willy-nilly ad nauseum. They simply can't do that. So what we see at the moment is kind of this unstable situation. Is the American dollar on its way out? Likely, but it could well take years or even decades. What will replace it? Very much up in the air. That basket that Fisk's article mentions, gee, is that a solution? My guess is that it isn't, for the simple reason that governments couldn't agree amongst themselves what would be the currencies, what would be the relevant percentages, and so on. So the stability imposed by America being the preeminent economic power after the Second World War just isn't there. We haven't had an honest currency since then. For that reason, we haven't had honest governments since then. And so I dare say that there'll be an element of turbulence with which we'll have to live for better or for worse for years to come.
I really appreciate you coming in. Thank you very much, Chris Leithner, once again.
Great pleasure.
Chris Leithner is with Leithner and Associates.